Well, good morning, Crossroads. Wherever you are around the world, we want to welcome you in worshiping our God with us this morning. So lift up your voice, lift your hands, and let's give him the praise that he deserves wherever you are this morning. Come on, let's do it. Done. Our souls awake to you and lift a song. We've seen the things that you have done, and still we know the best is yet to come. There's more to come, so open the all we need. You break our chains with sounds of victory, changing everything. So open the gates and let your glory come down, and open eyes and let our worship pour out. So
amazing grace. This is a failing love. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you.
Never stop working.
That is who you are. Yes, you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
Jesus, that is who you are. And you are working. The obstacles haven't even come yet. You've already worked a miracle. Father, just remind us that you got this. You've got us. You are faithful. And all we need to do is lift it up to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, Crossroads. Welcome to my office here at the Carroll Stream campus. We thought we'd mix up the location a little bit, give you guys something new to look at. So yeah, here we are. This is where all of the magic happens most of the time, some of the time, not really. But welcome, especially if you are new with us. We know that some of you might be tuning in because your cousin or your friend shared this on Facebook or gave you the link. And we just want to say welcome. We love that you're here. And better yet, we would love to meet you. And the best way for us to be able to do that while we can't really be together in person is for you to text. Text the phone number 94000 94000. If you text the word growth to that number, someone from our church will be able to connect with you. You'll get a couple of prompts and you can follow those in order to introduce yourself to us and for us to be able to introduce ourselves to you. Thank you for joining us. And what we want to do right now is I want to call your attention to something really specific in our church at this time. We know, we're not naive, that the summer months can kind of be weird when it comes to giving. There's a lot of vacations happening, there's a lot of travel, and we just know it's an age-old thing within the church world that the summer can kind of take a dip in terms of giving. And so what I wanna do is just call our attention to that and hope that together as a church, together as Crossroads, staff included, we can be mindful of that. We wanna encourage you to continue to give, maybe potentially more than you ever have, because here's why. We know that coming out of this season, this COVID-19 time that we've been in, we know that we are gonna have additional needs. We just know that's a part of the reality of this season that we're in. And so we're preparing for that. We are trying our best to steward in a way that sets us up well for this coming summer and this coming fall. But we need you to do your part. We need to all come together as Crossroads, as the church, and give, like I said, potentially more than we ever have. And so would you consider doing that? Would you pray about that as you're able, as God lays it on your heart, to support the ministries of Crossroads, not just as a result of COVID-19, but moving forward in the future? You can do that a couple of different ways. You can do that online. If you go to crossroadschurch.us, there is a way for you to give online there, or you can text. You can text any amount to 84321. If you send an amount in to that number, you will get some prompts that will allow you to give online using your phone. Another thing I wanna make you aware of really quick is that we are starting to ease back into normalcy here as much as we can. And one of the best ways that we're gonna be able to do that through the month of June is through small groups. So what we're doing is we're encouraging any of you that are comfortable. We know that's not all of you. Some of you might not be ready to do that yet. But any of you who are comfortable, resume your small groups in person. If you need to, you can gather here at the church. Email us at info@crossroadschurch.us and we'll help you schedule out use of the building here. But if you're willing, have it in your home. Have 10 people or less in your home if that's something that you're able to do, maybe in your backyard or something creative. We wanna encourage our church to sort of ease back into things as much as we're able. And right now that looks like small groups of gathering of 10 people or less. Maybe you wanna gather for the next couple of weeks with your small group to actually watch the service on a Sunday morning. Consider the ways that you might do that, get creative, and we're gonna be behind you 110%. Let's pray now for the offering that I mentioned earlier as we give back to God what he has given to us. Lord, I thank you that you are a God who provides. Lord, you have done that consistently, even though it's been hard to recognize during these weird times. And Lord, you will do that consistently through a tough summer, a very abnormal summer. And Lord, you will, we know, provide for the fall and for Crossroads moving forward. And so we ask in these moments, Lord, that you would do that, not just financially for our church, but I pray that you would do that for our people, Lord, who are in various needs right now. through the screen. Lord, you know what those needs are, and you can reach them, Lord, this morning, even just by providing your very presence. Lord, you can comfort us when we need that. And so, Lord, we surrender our need to you, not only as a church, but as individuals. And we pray that as a result of what is given to our church, Lord, not just in this season, but always, we pray that the result of that would be more and more and more people in your kingdom. Lord, more and more people who have a personal relationship with such a good, holy, loving God. So we pray that confidently. We pray that boldly, Lord, expecting that that is what you will do through the ministry of Crossroads. It's in your name we pray. Amen. And now we are going to Pastor Austin for our message this morning.
Good morning, church family. This is Pastor Austin again from my living room. So glad you are joining us online this morning. We got some exciting news this last week. The governor of Illinois has allowed us to start hosting 100-person gatherings. And we're not sure exactly when that will take place, but we're excited because we heard from you. During the survey that many of you took, you said you are excited to get back to joining us for in-person gatherings. And so we've been putting together a team. It's been over a month. A team has been placed to put together in order to provide a reopening plan. And we're calling it the Crossroads Task Force. They're making sure to do their due diligence so that your safety for reopening is our top priority. Having said that, I want to say those that still are going to worship from home, we're not going to forget about you. We want to make sure to still provide an experience you can watch from your home. Maybe it's because of your comfort level or maybe underlying health concerns, you need to worship from home a little longer. We understand that. We get that. We want to be accommodating for you, but we're just excited to host services in person soon. You'll be finding more information in the coming days about that. I did want to talk about another thing that happened this last week. As many of you probably have seen the video footage of the murder of George Floyd. It was excruciating to watch that film, to see a human take their last breath on camera. And as I wrestled through it, it's like, what do we as believers, as the Church of Jesus Christ, how should we think about these things of racial injustice in our nation? It's not that it's a new thing, it's just it's getting captured more on phones and cameras. So how should we think? And I what jumped out to me was 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8. And it goes like this, said, "Finally, all of you brothers and sisters in Christ, have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind." He says, unity of mind. We as the church need to have the unity of mind that this racial injustice is evil. It is not how God intends the world to live. One day we will be before the throne room of God, and every race, every color will stand before him and worship him in heaven. That's us allowing heaven to be brought to earth here and now. So we now have the unity of mind of calling what it is. Next is sympathy. That if you don't have a skin color that is profiled, that is attacked, that you would reach out, that you would talk to someone who does, sit yourself in their shoes. Next, he says, brotherly love. Everyone is created in the image of God, and with that is been given dignity by God himself. And so as brothers and sisters, we need to care about that. We need to care when someone is unjustly killed. That should grieve our hearts, and that's why he moves to tender heart. Your heart should have broken for when you saw that film. And if it didn't, can I be honest with you? You need to make things right in your heart with the Lord. Maybe it needs to be you need to repent before the Lord of your callous heart towards seeing someone be abused and murdered that way. Finally, he says, a humble mind. And this is thinking in your own life in a posture of humility. Where in my heart, in my life, is there some bias? There's maybe racism in my heart. And how do I expunge? I get rid of that and care for my brother. Where have I not stepped in to the joke that was said at work or to defend someone in need? I just think that the Lord calls us to these things. As a church, we need to rise up and be the champions of reconciliation that this world needs. And it can be done through the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's what provides hope in such wicked, evil times like now. So right now, I just want to pray for our nation, pray for our church as we navigate these things. Lord, right now we come to you. We know that you have created men and women in your image. And God, they have been given dignity before you. They've been given a soul. And God, you've called us to reach every single person, no matter who they are, what color of skin they have, with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, it's the only thing that can bring about reconciliation in the lives of people, those that are so hostile towards one another. And so, Lord, may we as the church rise up and say no more and champion the cause of the marginalized, that we would rise up and care for our brothers and sisters. Lord, we love you. We want to do what's right. So unleash your spirit upon us, we pray. Amen. Well, this morning, we're jumping into our text of 1 Peter. We're in a series called Strangers, and Peter is going to dive into marriage. How does marriage look in our day as strangers? Well, what does it look like to be married, to fight for that which God has created? And at times, marriage can be a ton of joy and satisfaction, and yet marriage at times can be agonizing and hard. We're going to jump into our text this morning. It's 1 Peter chapter 3. I have a surprise for you, though. At the end of the message, I'm going to invite my wife up to help talk through her experience in our marriage and what honor looks like. So as we dive in, we're diving in with the understanding that marriage thrives on honor. Let's read our text together. Likewise, wives, be subject to your own husbands, so that even some who do not obey the word, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives, when they see your respectful and pure conduct. Do not let your adorning be external, the braiding of hair, or the putting on of gold jewelry, or clothing you wear. But let your adorning be the hidden person of the heart, with the imperishable beauty of a gentle and a quiet spirit, which is God's sight is very precious. For this is how the holy women who hoped in God used to adorn themselves, by submitting to their own husbands, as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord. And you are her children if you do good and do not fear anything that is frightening. So he starts off by addressing wives. Wives, how you show honor, if you're writing something down, you can write this down. Wives show honor through action and attitude. Through action and attitudes. He starts by an imperative. Do this. Be subject or be submissive. Submit to your own husbands, he calls us to. Now, I get that word has fraught with a lot of implications. Some of us might be, oh, what does that mean? I don't know if I like that terminology. Well, Peter here is not talking about inequality. He referenced that in verse 7, that we are co-heirs to the grace of life. So men and women are created equal in God's eyes. It's not a question of superiority, but of functionality. That God has placed our husbands as leaders in the home. And we organize ourselves under their leadership. It's the idea of voluntarily relinquishing your rights. We saw that with civil government. And with our bosses last week, that we submit and order ourselves under their authority. Let me paint a picture a little bit more of describing submission by telling you what submission is not. That might help us out this morning. First, that submission is not agreeing on everything. It's not that you left your opinions at the altar when you got married, wives. You have ideas, you've got things to contribute in this marriage. And so, guys, let me say this, that it's not about putting your wife under your thumb. Whatever I do goes. No, that's not honoring at all. And she doesn't have to agree with everything you say or think. Second is the will of the husband submission is not the will of the husband over the will of Christ. If the husband's asking you to do something that is in direct violation against King Jesus, that supersedes submitting to your husband. Lastly is acting in fear. It's not a cowering, I'm always worried about what my husband thinks and afraid of him. Let me speak to those that might have abuse in their background or maybe currently. That's a hard thing. And Scripture's not teaching you to stay underneath that abuse, but to get help, to seek out help in that circumstance. But knowing that submission is something that God intends for our benefit, for the wife's good. He goes on to say that in the first century, husbands were often unbelievers and wives were the ones who were Christians. He says, not just don't speak at all, but your actions will speak louder than your words to your husband. You don't have to nag him. You don't have to sit around the supper table and do an altar call of prayer, but simply living out an honorable life before him. A silent life before him can communicate volumes to win him over to the faith. He goes on to say, talks about the attitude, that which is inside, your character. He says, your beauty does not depend on anything that you buy. Now, God is not against beauty. He loves me. He gave us eyes to see beauty. So take as much time as you need in the morning to get ready. But as much time as you take to get ready in the morning for your external self, make sure we're spending time for our internal self as well. That the character of the heart, the indwelling spirit who dwells in us, that we're minding that, we're taking care of that. My wife and I, we bought this home that you see here, and it was a fixer-upper. And when we got there, it was the overwhelming feeling of all that we have to do in the house. And we looked outside and thought all that we have to do outside the house. And we had to come to the recognition that we're going to focus on the inside before we move to the outside, because the inside is where we're going to dwell, where we're going to live. The boys are going to run around and play. And then we'll move to the outside when that comes about. And so know that the inside is the most important. It's where true beauty comes from, because that is the dwelling place of the Spirit of God. So what goes on the inside? What should be said of wives that are living as followers of Christ? He says, to gentleness and quiet. Gentleness here is the word meekness. And it's not that you're a doormat or you quickly get brushed past and you don't have opinions, you don't have a backbone. That's not what this is. It's power under control. It's the idea of a horse that's been bridled. Where you have this strength about you as wives that is under the control of the Spirit of God. That is not unruly. It's not out of balance, but rather in submission to the Lord. The next he says is quiet. It's not that you never talk. It's the idea of calm. It's the glassy lake before in the beginning of the day, where it's calm. And she's the woman who sets the tone in the morning. When the chaos around the home is going crazy, she's that ballast for the family. And Peter, he loves examples. So he moves to an example of a heroine of the faith, Sarah. And he says, Sarah used to call Abraham Lord. Now, my wife Emily has never called me Lord, so I don't know if she's listening to... No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. Let me explain what that means. Lord here is lowercase. It's a simple way of saying a mister or sir. It's the idea that she gave honor to Abraham. And let me tell you, you look back at Abraham and Sarah's life, it was a mess, okay? It was not perfect by any standard. Abraham was a little bit of a bonehead, okay? he was a little bit of a guy who, when they went to Egypt, he said to his wife, you be my sister, okay, because I don't want to die. And then he goes and he lets her go into the harem of Pharaoh. And it's like, what just happened? Pharaoh or Abraham, you're out of control. What are you thinking, right? And not only that, but he comes home one day and he says, "Yo, Sarah, I've been talking to God, and he told us to move." And she said, "Okay, great. Well, where are we moving?" And he's like, "I don't know. He just told us to move." And Sarah, submitting and following Abraham's leadership and his connection to the Lord, she packs up the tent and she begins to move with him. I mean, Sarah, she couldn't ever imagine what God was going to do through her marriage to a difficult man. Maybe you're in that spot right now where you're in a marriage that's very difficult. God's not through with your marriage. He wants your marriage to thrive, and the way it thrives is through honor. So wives, how you express honor is through your action and your attitude. He turns then to husbands in verse 7. Verse 7 says this, "Likewise, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel, since they are heirs with you of the grace of life, so that your prayers may not be hindered." Here, oh, wives, they have 6 verses. They need the details. Guys have 1 verse, and it's matched with a 2x4 over the head, a threat at the very end. It's like God's going to slap them over the head if they don't get this right. He tells husbands, and if you're writing this down, you can see this. Husbands, show honor through knowing and treasuring your wife. How husbands do that is they know their wife and they treasure her. He says, live with her in an understanding way. The original says this, live with your wife according to knowledge. Guys, your number one job is to know your wife. Study her. You went to the university of your wife. You ought to know what gifts, what talents, the way God has made her. And your job is to create an ecosystem in your home, leading your home so that she flourishes. She flourishes spiritually, emotionally, physically. Everything is designed so that submitting to you is easy because you know her. You know what's going on in her heart. You've dug deep to ask her the questions that reveal her heart. May it never be said that her counselor, if she sees one, or her best friend knows her better than you do. The dictionary definition for my wife, Emily Adams, is still being written. I have to continually have to go back to that dictionary definition to know her, to search her out, to spend time with her, to slow down and dig long enough to reveal her heart. Your job is to lead her in a way that she is flourishing. Second, he says to show her honor as the weaker vessel. Weaker vessel doesn't mean she's weak intellectually, emotionally, or spiritually. It's just simply the sheer strength. Men are usually stronger than women. And see, he says, show her honor, meaning treat her with respect. Honor her. Give her the highest position in your life. Guys, more than your video games, more than your dudes you hang out with, more than your job, your career, hear me, your money. Your wife needs to be at the highest position in your life. All those other things don't matter. You've taken a vow before God to treasure her, to cherish her, to serve her in what she needs. How do you cherish and treasure your wife? Well, you treat her as your own body. Ephesians 5 says this, husbands, love your wives as their own bodies. It's for us. What we want is how we get along and how our desires are met. That's how it should be with caring for our wives. I would say this, men, maybe the reasons you're not in a good place in your marriage is because you have not been taking the initiative you need to lead your family well. John Piper says it this way. Who uses the word "let's" more? Who says, "Let's go to church, fam"? Let's go and find a mentor to mentor us during the season. Let's go get counseling if we need. Is it you, husband? Or do you hear that more from your wife? Are you taking the initiative, driving forward the family so your wife is flourishing and she's enjoying life with you? That's on you, men, to know what makes her happy and pursue it, to know what makes her hurt and avoid it. See, God will hold us accountable. He says that at the end, that God will mute our prayers. Hear this warning, men. God will mute our prayers if we are not honoring our wives. I don't want that to be said of me, that my effectiveness in ministry, my effectiveness in my home, my effectiveness is actually reduced because I have not honored my wife well. He says, your prayers will be hindered if you don't abide by this. That's a warning for us, men. May that not be so. So men, make sure that you are knowing your wife, you're at university of your wife, and that you are pursuing her, you're treasuring her and cherishing her. At this time, I want to invite my wife up. She's going to come and just share with us of what it looks like on her perspective of what this honor looks like. Because remember, marriage thrives on honor. At this time, I want to invite my wife, Emily, where you at? Come on down. She's going to share with us a little bit here. Welcome. Say hi to the people in the camera.
Hi, church fam. We miss you guys so much. And I just can't wait to give all of you a big hug when I see you again. So here's my big virtual hug.
There you go. So we're talking about marriage thrives on honor. How does honor look like in our marriage?
Yeah. First, I want to just say that in no way do Austin and I have a perfect marriage.
You don't? Okay.
I say amen. Amen.
Yeah. That's true. It is true. 100%.
It's true.
It's usually my fault.
I don't know about that, but, and it's our goal to constantly be working on our marriage and to make it better than it was yesterday. And it's our hope that you today will pick up on something from this message that will help you in your marriages to help you thrive. That's our hope, is that our marriages will thrive and reflect Jesus Christ beautifully. So one of the biggest ways that I feel honored in our marriage is that I know I am part of this team. My thoughts and opinions are valued by Austin. I remember when we were getting ready to buy this house, I was so hesitant and worried because that's my personality is very detailed. I don't know how we're going to do this. He's more, let's do it. So it was a process where a lot of give and take, him asking a lot of questions, and for us to arrive at a decision together to do something this big. I don't know if you have any thoughts on that.
No, it's true. I think we often come to consensus on things. If there's not this joint agreement of like, yes, this is what we should be doing, we wait and we hold it off and pray a little while before that. Sometimes when it doesn't, we don't have the time, the luxury of time. I will make a decision. And, you know, the thing is, she trusts me and how we move forward. So
I trust that his intent is for our good, and I will submit to his decision and leadership for our home and our family. Another way that I feel honored in our marriage is that Austin really aims to know me. Early on when we were dating, this might be helpful for some of you that are feeling stuck and just where do I even start? What questions do I even ask to get to know my spouse better? We were encouraged to read the books For Him Only, For Her Only, or For Men Only, For Women Only. That's what it was called. And read the book about our own self. So I read the one about women, and to underline things and mark things that are really true for you that you really identified with, and to also write out notes like, this is not me at all. Don't worry about this part. And then we traded books, and it was just so eye-opening, and it made it fun to learn more about each other and to do that together. So that's one thing that I would definitely recommend doing. And then kind of tied in with that, he encourages me to operate in my strengths. He knows my strengths, and then he therefore can encourage me in them. I think one of the simple ways we do this is with our finances. I just happen to be better with the details. And that's a way that I can serve our family. And he lets me run in my lane. I think you had an illustration on that, right?
So there's a pastor that gave this illustration of a wife is like a Ferrari and a husband is like an F-150, all right? Where it's like there's differences of the two vehicles and they both have strengths and they complement each other well. So if you're going to go get mulch or move a bunch of pile of bricks, You use the F-150, right? But if you want to go on a date or if you want to race your friend or whatever, use the Lamborghini, right? So there's differences in who we are, and we can jointly come together, and those things can be very beautiful in marriage.
Exactly. And I think lastly and most importantly, I just want to say that he cares for my spiritual well-being. It's so important for me to see him leading our home well in his own spiritual life, watching him do his devotions and to study God's word and to want to know God more really encourages me to do likewise. And sometimes it can be something as simple as, hey, let me watch the boys so that you can go have some time with God and have it be uninterrupted time in prayer and scripture. And that just really helps refresh me and encourage my spiritual walk. And even just encouraging me to be in a Bible study or to go to small group. Like, let's do this. Let's do small group together. Those are ways that he can lead me in that and help me to grow spiritually.
Well, thanks for coming on here and chatting with us about honor. We want the best for you. We know Peter does, Jesus does. Mm-hmm. And so we know that, you know, as we've seen here, marriage thrives with honor. And so seek to honor the other person. So I'm going to pray. We've got worship here right at the end of our service. We're also doing Zoom calls as well after each service. So join us in the link on the comment section. We have a Zoom link there for you. We'd love to say hello to you that way. So let's pray together. God, thank you so much for marriage. We know it is a good gift from you. And God, we know that it can be at times difficult. And so we want to express our care and our love through honor of the other person. And so God, we thank you so much for the marriages in our church. We pray for them to thrive, they would grow. God, this would be a season of reconciliation for some. God, that they would make some great movements towards bettering their marriage, God. And so Lord, we just love you. We thank you again for the institution of marriage. In your name we pray, amen.
Amen.
All right, we'll see you soon in the comments.
Love you guys.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Waymaker, miracle work, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God.
God, you are sovereign over it all. through the most difficult situations of our life, God, you continue to reign. Seated high upon the throne, we worship you and give you the praise and adoration that you deserve. May we continue to live lives that bring you glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name, all God's people said, amen. Have a great Sunday.